to be normal. I never wanted you to be normal. I'm not gonna give you a normal life. I'm not gonna give you normal perspective. You're not gonna live normal dreams, and you're not gonna win normal wars. You're gonna fight completely abnormal battles. You're gonna rage war again. You're gonna be ruined for fearlessness. You're gonna be ruined for weakness. You're gonna be ruined for weakness. You're gonna be ruined. Hey, good morning, church. So good to be with you. And just a huge honor. I'm still kind of thrown back. I'm sure everybody says this when they come here, but this stage is awesome. Like, I've never been able to see through the stage before, and I've always wondered what kind of wires we're going through. But this is your normal, and I'm kind of jealous, to be honest with you, because there is so much in this room. There's so much in this vision. How many are excited that you get to come to this church? That, yeah, to every church, you get to come to Fearless Church. And I'm blown away. I remember just journeying with Pastor Jeremy and Pastor Christy for so long back when we were all still in youth ministry, and I was out in Texas, and they would come and speak, and they had their band Worth Dying For, which you remember, and so they would come in, and just to see what God has done and how He's plowed so much. You guys have taken so much ground. It's incredible. And let me just put to you like this, because I went and watched a few YouTube videos. I watch from time to time just because I want to check in on my friends and a church that I've loved so much from afar. But let me just keep it real, okay? You people are spoiled up in this church right here, all right? I get to go to a lot of different churches, a lot of different conferences. Sometimes I feel like I go to church more than Jesus sometimes. That's how I feel like, all right? And you guys have incredible worship. Come on, do you love this worship team? This phenomenal, anointed. And then you've got a team that's caring, that has vision. And then I think it's a pure reflection of some incredible leaders, Pastor Jeremy and Pastor Christy. Come on, do you love your lead pastors? Just phenomenal leaders who are leading with such strength and stepping in to their destiny with such grace. And I know you guys have received from that. But I recognize this is my first time here. So let me kind of tell you my story so you know where this crazy Mexican is coming from, okay? I grew up on the border of the United States and Mexico. And you have heard of my city, but for all the wrong reasons, all right? Nobody vacations in my city. You go there for one of two reasons. You go there, number one, to visit family, or number two, to do something illegal. That's the only reason that you're in my city. No, I'm not lying. If you've ever seen an episode of Narcos, if you heard about all the drug trafficking, cartel, those are all my cousins. All right, so Christmas is fun or the FBI is involved. There is never an in-between. So you can imagine growing up in that kind of environment. By the age of 12, I found myself with a drug addiction, a lust problem, and an anger issue, but I love to play basketball. Come on, anybody love to hoop in here? Anyone, all three of you, that's great. And so I would go to this church that had a gym, and they would open up their gym right before their youth service, and they would try to get all the students from the gym into the youth service. Well, I would never stay. I would dip and leave and find somewhere else to play. But the youth pastor got involved in my life, and one day he came to me, he said, "Hey, do you want to go to church camp?" And I honest to God, I had no idea what this was. He said, "Hey, do you want to go to church camp?" And I said, "Is there going to be hot girls at this camp?" And he said, "Well, we're going to go for Jesus." I said, "Fine, you can go for Jesus. I'm going to get some phone numbers. I'm going to camp." What I didn't realize is on the first night of that camp, I got saved, I got filled with the Spirit, and I got called into ministry all in one night. Game-changing night for your boy. And from that point forward, I went to Bible college. I went into business. We helped streamline the internet sales process for every luxury car company except Lamborghini. So by the age of 21 and 22, my wife and I had made financial goals that most people retire at. But it doesn't matter how wealthy you are. If you're not in the will of God, you'll be miserable. So then God says, "Hey, sell everything you have, empty the bank accounts, and move to Sri Lanka." How many know where Sri Lanka's at? Two of you, that's great. All right, so Sri Lanka is 40 miles south of India. This was in the middle of a civil war with religious fanaticism, the whole thing. I'm talking about, I remember mortar shells blowing up down the road from my house, suicide bombers bombing the hotels we would stay in. But in the middle of all that chaos, God was still raising up His church, and we were seeing daily salvations, signs, wonders, healings, miracles, breakthrough, freedom. Today, that church is 8 campuses. They just planted one in Dubai. They're going to plant another one in Milan, Italy. I'm so excited. And then we came back, took over student ministry, and we just watched a sweeping revival come through our young people, where we just began to position and weaponize these risk takers who were going to be influencers, who were going to have volume to their voice and weight to their words, and we're going to be dripping with anointing and begin to walk into any area. As we just started to say, any area I go becomes dangerous. I get dangerous to cancer, right? I'm dangerous to depression. I'm dangerous to demons. I'm dangerous to hopelessness. And we started watching students just begin to interrupt classrooms, interrupt malls, interrupt people's. They thought they was going to have dinner and they were going to have revival and a meal at the same time. And we just didn't know how to live another way. And so we came back and took over at Christ for the Nations. We started leading there. And for the last 10 years, that's a Bible college of 68 campuses around the world. And really the last 11 years of my life, I've dedicated to raising and releasing the next wave of influencers that are going to storm nations in the place of politics and education and medicine, in the church, in the arts. Come on, anybody feel like God has postured and positioned the church to begin to move the kingdom of God forward, regardless of what challenges or limitations or circumstances? Come on, anybody else got faith for this? Your name is Fearless for a reason. You didn't just pick this church because you got a good building. There's a prophetic claim to this house in the name of it. And so really, that's what I get to do. I get to help journey the church to a place of unity and strength where we can begin to take nations and cities and lay them at the feet of Jesus. And I believe that Fearless Church is one of those frontline movements where God is speaking and He's chiseling and you're at the tip of the spear. And what God is doing is He's continually moving you forward into places of risk, into places of pioneering. Come on, that took on a whole new word at your conference. Just God moving you forward in something. But I can't, there's no way I could do this alone. I've been married for 17 years. I have 4 beautiful kids. She wants more. I don't. Pray for her, not me. Okay? I'm done. I did my duty. I did my time. I put in my work. I put in my effort. I'm done. But I can't think of a better place to be than right here at Fearless with you. Come on, anybody else excited about being in church? Now, I don't know about you, but I don't do no quiet church. I just don't do quiet church. Can you tell? I'm too Hispanic for that. Like, we the type of people. Come on, where are my caramel people at? Where are the brown people at? Come on, caramel, talk to me. Yeah, we got caramel. And we got some chocolate, folk. Come on, chocolate, make some noise. Yeah, we got a whole lot of whipped cream up in this room right here. All right? We all one big sundae. Everybody got a sweet tooth up in here. All right? But listen, I don't do no quiet church. I believe a quiet church is a dead church. And I believe the Word of God deserves a response. Can I get a good amen? I believe that we should give the Word the home field advantage plus, all right? That play, because I love playing on my home court because I had the most crowd support. Well, let's give the Word the most crowd support this morning. Are you with me? Can you do that? Somebody say yes. Say, come on, somebody. Say, some on, somebody. I don't even know how to spell that. Government education. I don't even know how to spell that. Are you ready for the Word? Come on, Fearless Church. Are you ready for the Word? I believe you. I believe you. Hey, turn on your Bible and go to Acts 3. Yes, I know what generation we live in, for crying out loud. Turn on your Bible and go to Acts, the 3rd chapter. If you open it, that's fine. If you turn it on, that's fine, all right? It's the Bible that says it's the Word of God that's living and active, not what it shows up on or what it's written on, all right? Acts chapter 3, I felt like coming off of this incredible blazing fire of conference and then God uniquely strategizing and positioning me to be here, I couldn't help but pray over the last 2 days that God kept putting this word provoke on the inside of me. I felt like what God started in conference was not the ending. It was the beginning. I feel like a page has been turned, a season has been shifted. Are you with me? And I feel like it's my assignment to provoke the fearless ones. Come on, do I have any mighty ones in this room? Do I have any birdie ones in this room? Do I have any dangerous ones in this room? I feel like my assignment is to provoke you this morning. And so I want to read from this text in Acts chapter 3 where we have Peter. And this is one of Peter's defining moments. Now, everybody's had defining moments. Some of these moments have marked us for good. And then some of these moments we wish we could forget about, but they are defining moments. And this is one of Peter's shining moments. This is his glow up right here, okay? And so Peter, he has been traveling with Jesus for three and a half years. And then he comes to the climax of one of his journey points in his life where he denies Jesus not once, not twice, but thrice. Anybody remember this, right? Jesus does restore him in John 21. Peter, do you love me? Peter, do you love me? Peter, do you love me? And then he sets him back in to his destiny track. And as he does this, he makes a few last-minute adjustments in Peter's life. One of them is, don't go start churches, don't start preaching, don't start ministering until you get the promise of the Father, which is the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And then, once he gets the baptism of the Holy Spirit in Acts chapter 2, we find Peter is just all kinds of different. He is a different animal, a different man. He is from a different planet. He is anchored no longer in this world. He is anchored in the kingdom of God and in this one. Are you following? He's anchored in that world, but exists in this one. Are you following me? And so here you have Peter in one of his shining moments. Let's read here Acts chapter 3, verse 1. It says, now Peter and John went up together to the temple at the hour of prayer, the ninth hour, and a certain man lame from his mother's womb was carried, whom the people laid daily at the gate. Everybody say daily. Come on, say it again. Say daily. Whom the people laid daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to ask alms from those who enter the temple, who, seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, asked for alms and said this and gave the man his attention. Now watch this. Verse 4. And fixing his eyes on him with John, Peter said, look at us. So the man gave him his attention, expecting to receive something from him. Now, before I read verse 6, I got a confession to make, all right? Just honest confession. Before we read verse 6, I got to tell you, I love verse 6. I love verse 6 for a lot of reasons. I love verse 6 because verse 6 forces you into some choices. Verse 6 asks you to step into options. Verse 6 no longer gives you a sideline view. Verse 6 doesn't give you perspective. It gives you a choice. You either do it or you don't. You're about it or you're not. You're a beast or you're not. Everybody wants to be a beast until it's time what real beasts do. And I love verse 6 because the devil hates verse 6. Hell gets nervous about verse 6. I love verse 6 because heaven gets excited about verse 6. In verse 6, it tells you, what verse 6 does to the life of a believer is totally different than what it could do if you said no rather than you saying yes. I love this. Verse 6 says, as this man is saying, give me something. He's expecting because he's begging. And Peter says, silver and gold I do not have, but what I do have, come on church, I give you. In the name of Jesus, rise up and walk. Come on, do you love verse 6? I love for the authority of verse 6. I love the power of verse 6. Look at verse 7. It says, he took him by the right hand and lifted him up, and immediately his feet, ankle bones received strength. So he, leaping up, stood, walked, and entered the temple with them, walking, leaping, and praising God. And all the people saw him walking and praising God. Then they knew it was he who sat begging alms at the beautiful gate of the temple, and they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to him. Let's pray for a moment. Let's pray for a moment. Then we're going to unpack all of this. Holy Spirit, I ask for the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Jesus Christ. And I thank you now, God, for what you're doing. I thank you that that spirit of wisdom and revelation is going to flood every heart. I speak to this atmosphere, both here, online, at home, wherever you're watching. And I say that you are full of faith. And you are full of hope, and you are full of peace, and you are full of joy. And I come against every limit, every restriction, every barrier, every lie, every demonic harassment is broken right now in Jesus' name. And I call every man and every woman into their season. I call them into their rhythm. I call them into their destiny where they have felt out of pace and out of sync. I call them into supernatural alignment with what you're doing, God. We thank you that there's fresh hunger. We thank you that fresh desire has overtaken us, God. We thank you for fresh language, not just a fresh touch, God, but a fresh transformation. And may there be a holy disruption in the kingdom of darkness as a result of every man and every woman and every child represented at Fearless, God. I thank you that you are positioning them, Lord, that you aren't just carelessly causing them to live through their life, but Lord, you are designing and you are orchestrating, you are pinpointing and you are calling to, you are keeping back and you are moving forward, you're accelerating and deaccelerating, you're tearing things down, you're dealing with enemies we never knew we had, and you're giving us victories we could never have gotten had we not looked at your eyes and said, God, mark my life. And so I break every limit, I break every excuse, I break every denomination that would try to come and influence you to somehow pour cold water on your fire, to have ashes where there used to be fire, that you would ignite something so fresh, that you would do something so deep, that you would cause a supernatural transformation like never before In the mighty name of Jesus, we are not okay with just a small fire. We are not okay with just a small touch. We are not okay with a spiritual goosebump. We want a historic outpouring of the Holy Spirit in fire like we have never seen before. We want you to move, God, in our city and in our families, in our jobs and in our communities like never before. Cause a divine turnaround to happen in the mighty name of Jesus. And everyone shout it. Amen. I feel like praying this morning. You're taking notes, and I surely hope that you are. The title of this message is Ruined. I feel like this is exactly what God has been doing to you. And I'm talking to, I know I could talk to the capital C church, but let me talk to family in the room. God has been ruining you. And you might think that this is pretty mean. I'm not talking about ruined in the natural sense. I'm not talking about when something gets ruined that it loses value. I'm talking about when you get touched by heaven, you become so ruined that your value begins to increase because you don't look at storms, you don't look at troubles, you don't even feel like you're being tested. You're being trusted with problems. You're being trusted with giants. You're being trusted with opposite. You're ruined. Intimidation does not come on you. Overwhelmness does not come on you. You know how to pray that thing down. You know how to prophesy to that mountain. You know how to speak to those things. You are ruined. You live totally different. It's a whole, I have this message called Stay Woke. I think there's something about understanding a supernatural wokeness. When you are seeing things, eyes that look are common, but eyes that see totally rare because you've been ruined. I remember one of my defining moments like Peter. I was going to a prayer meeting at a school. I was leading with a friend. She and I were leading this prayer meeting, and we were walking back, and you kind of had to know where to park at this school. And the only reason I know that is because I got kicked out of this high school. So that's another story. And I remember I was walking her back, and we walk up on her car. No lie. We walk up on her car, and she's like, "Where's my car?" I said, "You park right here." She said, "I park right here." I said, "You park right here?" She said, "I park right here." I said, "You can't park here. There's no parking sign right there." You know what she said? "They don't mean that." I said, "Well, apparently they do, because your car is like no longer here." And Camino, sarcasm might be a fruit of the Spirit. I don't know. It's not even scriptural. Anyways, and I remember, I said, "You better call the number on the sign." Sure enough, they towed her car away. She's like, "Hey, can you give me a ride?" I'm like, "Dope, no problem. Let's do it," right? So we get in the car. This is where I grew up, okay? West Texas, it's bright, sunny outside. Sunny. I mean, there's no clouds. It's desert. It's dry. It's brown. Everything's brown. The ground's brown. The food's brown. The people are brown. Everything's brown. It's all brown, okay? So I remember, we go in. It's bright, sunny outside, late morning. And I remember we roll up on this dirt lot, cars everywhere, and one trailer. And I remember as soon as the door, passenger, closes behind us, boom, just like this. It's like all the sunlight vanished, just like that. It was completely dark. I'm talking like a horror movie, completely dark. And all of a sudden, there's a light flickering. That's the only light on. It's flickering at the end of a long hallway, flickering like this. I don't even know what this is in LA, but this is flickering today, okay? And then this figure of a man appears, and it yells at us, "What do y'all want?" So I told my friend, I said, hey, that is talking to you. And she said, "I'm the one to park in no parking zone." He said, "You park in no parking zone? How can you park in no parking? Stop parking no park. Jimmy, run the curb. Stop parking no park. I'll never get to go back. Stop parking no park. I'm trying to pick it up. Stop parking no parking zone." We're like, okay. Now, I don't know what kind of Christians you hung out with, but when I was growing up, I hung out with the crazies because they was always trying to fight the devil everywhere we went. Anybody know this type of Christian? All right. I'm telling you, we was always trying to fight the devil everywhere. We trying to find demons in trees, car batteries, popsicles. It did not matter. We was going to fight the devil today and win, right? So I'm standing there while whatever that was walks into it, back into its cave. My friend comes and tells me, she's like, "Chris, we have been sent of the Lord here." And I said, no. I said, "You have been sent to the Lord here." I knew where to park. She said, "Stop playing." I said, "You stop playing." She said, "Stop playing." I said, "You stop playing." She said, "Stop playing." I said, "You stop playing." She said, "Come on, let's pray." I said, "Fine." So I did what any Christian does in this situation. I pretended to pray. Come on, anybody ever done that? Y'all ever pretend to pray? Pretend, don't you judge me up in here. All right, y'all ever pretend to worship? When you pretend, you know it because you oversell it. You know what I'm saying? So I'm sitting there pretending to pray. Sitting there with the tambourine. It's all whimsical, you know, the whole thing. And I remember I'm sitting there overselling this prayer moment that I'm not having, and then God speaks to me. And he says, son, I want you to wash that man's feet. I said, what? He said, son, wash his feet. I said, no, you wash his feet. Yeah, first, what you don't know about me is I'm sort of a germaphobe. Before a pandemic, I'm going to tell you, I'm a day one, been living this life, all right? If you needed tips, you should have watched me for a while, okay? I ain't going to get nervous, you know what I'm saying? So I remember he's like, watch this. I don't do that, all right? I don't drink after nobody. I don't eat after nobody. I won't even drink after my wife, all right? I'll kiss her in tongues, but I will not drink after her. That's nasty. I won't do that, all right? And so I remember God's like, hey, wash your feet. Wash his feet. And I'm like, you wash his feet. And there's this argument, but I feel the holy pressure. Son, wash his feet. I'm like, you created it. You wash his feet. He's like, son, wash his feet. I'm like, come here. First off, we don't even know what that is. And secondly, I'm not washing his feet. You wash his feet. I mean, I can feel this pressure come in. Wash his feet. Till finally I just said, fine. So I sneak back into the little kitchen. I grabbed this coffee mug. They only have cold water in this nasty, crusty coffee mug, all right? I'm thinking as soon as I pour cold water on this man's hoof, he gonna punch me in the throat. So I come over, and this man comes out, and this is a big, hairy, sweaty dude. This guy come out, can't believe parking no parking zone. Who gonna park or no park? He's cracking everybody up on the way in, okay? And he's like, and sits down, and I said, sir, listen, I'm sorry, but we're Christians. God speaks to us. And he told me that he wants me to wash your feet. And this guy said, you want to wash my feet? And I said, yes. And he said, okay. I was like, wait a minute. That's too fast. This dude's a freak. That was way too fast. And he said, okay. Now I went over and I remember I took off his shoe, y'all. I remember his shoe. I know what death smells like. It smells like what was ever in his shoe. Then I peeled his sock down like it was I peeled his sock like it was a banana. Like it was a moist brownie wrapped in plastic wrap, and I'm peeling his sock, and then I came over the cracks of his heels, and he had cracks in his heels that you could shove dead elephant bodies all up in these heels. It was just like another mouth on the back of his heel, just like that. Then I came over the top of his feet, and he had the hairiest feet you have ever seen in your life. Looked like a bunch of spiders having a meeting on the top of his foot. If the wind would blow like that, it would have done like this right here. And then he had one of those big toenails that was yellow. How does that happen? Yellow. I'm talking about yellow, like highlighter, glow in the dark, radioactive, yellow. I remember I prayed. I said, Lord, this is proof that you hate me. And I'll never forget. I'm sitting there looking at these feet, having a traumatic experience. I remember I took the water and I poured it on this man's hoof, started combing his hair. I'm just kidding. I'm just being stupid this morning. Anyways, and I'm starting to watch this water come off like black gray. And I remember, this is how I started my prayer. I said, Lord, these feet have seen some rough years. But as soon as I said this, it's like something shifted on the inside of me. I said, Lord, these feet have seen some rough years. Boom. But I believe these are years the enemy has stolen from him. In fact, I see that he's married. His wife's name is this. I see he has two sons. Their names are this and this. And I see that he's separated right now. But Lord, this is a generational curse that needs to be broken because his great-grand did this, his dad did this, his grandfather did this. And right now, in the authority of Jesus, I say that he's a good husband and he's a good father and he'll stay committed and whatever's broken, you'll make right. And I thank you, whatever's out of alignment, we'll put back into alignment. And Lord, I just ask you to sabotage the plans of the enemy right now and that you would wake up this mighty man of God, that you would touch, and this big hairy dude starts to cry. I mean, this dude is having like a spiritual seizure in the chair, just like this. I look at my friend and we catch eyes, and she's like, and I'm like, sissy, you know, like I'm this great man of God. I'll never forget, this man gave his life to Jesus that day. Come on, can we give God praise for that? But saying all that to get to this moment, I remember I got in the car and I was mad, family. I'm not lying. I was mad. I got in the car and I'm like, no, we're going to talk. Jesus, you need to get in this car. You're going to get in the car. You're going to get in the car. We're going to talk. You can't just show up in my life unannounced like that and just expect me to wash everybody's patas all over the place and I'll just be okay with it. I'm not sitting here to do that. All right, you didn't send me here. I'm not on a foot washing ministry. What you trying to do to me? I said, Lord, how am I supposed to live the same? How am I supposed to live the same knowing that you can do that? I had never been used by God like that. You've never told me to do anything like that. How? And this is what I said. I feel like you're ruining me. And I felt like the Lord shouted back with one of the loudest shouts he's ever put in my ears. He said, exactly. He said, son, I never asked you to be normal. I never wanted you to be normal. I'm not going to give you a normal life. I'm not going to give you normal perspective. You're not going to live normal dreams, and you're not going to win normal wars. You're going to fight completely in normal battles. You're going to rage war again. You're going to be ruined for fearlessness. You're going to be ruined for weakness. You're going to be ruined for weakness. You're going to be ruined. I believe what God has been doing in this house is he's been trying to ruin you. He's not been trying to keep you the same way. You're trying to fight for your normal. God has no problem tearing this wall down and tearing that excuse down and getting rid of that moment and relieving you from that stress and that pressure. And he's putting this accuracy to your focus, this clarity to your vision, and he's ruining you now because he's never asked you to be normal. He's never wanted you to be. If God wanted you to be normal, he should never have given you this book. He should have never sent the Holy Spirit. He should have never put you in Fearless Church. But let it be said that ruined ones were rising, and they were coming into our day, and we were going to take ground in abnormal ways. I don't want to be normal. I don't pray normal prayers. I don't think normal thoughts. How many more people in this room have been sensing God has been causing me to be inconvenienced, to be uncomfortable? I'm talking about a holy discomfort with the way you are. Not things, forget circum. The way you are in this day, in this circumstance. And what really needed to change wasn't all this, but was this, and he's ruining you. Where are the ruined ones at? God has been trying to ruin you since the day you met him. God is trying to ruin you even before you meet him. Let's be honest, some of you were weird before you came to this church. Now that you're a part of this church, were you just weird on purpose? This is what happens when you're ruined. What I have noticed is that ruined people, they don't make excuses, they make moves. Ruined people, they don't see things just off of surface value. They're not moved by headlines and social media feeds and opinion polls. No, ruined people are moved by a rush and a mighty wind. Ruined people are moved by the voice of many waters. Ruined people will follow the cloud, even if it means behind enemy lines. I don't mind being in the enemy's camp if it means I'm ruined and I'm destined and I'm established. Where are the ruined people at in LA who want a transformation in the city that's going to be sustained because you're ruined? You didn't come here to be the same. Let me tell you, let me give you three things if you're going to live a ruined life. Number one, don't go back to normal. Why would you want to go back? Let's talk about conference. Why would you want to go back to who you were before conference and be that person when God undid and redid? You unlearned and relearned. Are you following me? He untied and then reestablished. Why would you want to go back to that? Don't go back to normal. You know, the truth is, this is familiar language to my wife and I because we don't make normal moves. We leave corporate America. We leave Fortune 500 jobs. I'm corporate spotted to be a VP of Mercedes-Benz and Lexus as 20 years old. And then God says, sell everything you have, give it all away. Who does that? Not normal people. I'm from the hood. I remember one of my first checks was for like $10,000. I didn't know you could make $10,000 legally. I knew how to make it other ways, and it didn't come in a check. It came in a pillowcase stashed under a car that you picked up after 11 p.m. Some of you shaking your head like, that's the streets talking right there. That's the real. I don't want to go back to normal. People are like, you don't look like you're from the hood. I don't want to look like where I've been. I want to look like where I'm going. And I believe that what you look like right now as a church is where you're going. What you look like as a husband is where you're going. What you look like as a wife is where you're going. What you look like as a son and a daughter of God is you're ruined. Don't go back to normal. I'm raising weird kids. I had my daughter's birthday party last night. She's turning 12. She's a queen. I'm telling you, she's more mature than two of me. I'm not even lying. The other day I was watching football, and I'll never forget, she came onto my couch and she goes, Dad. I said, yeah, baby. She said, how's your marriage? You and mom good? When you pray about anything, how's your marriage? I'm like, you can't even spell marriage. Go somewhere else with that. That's welcome to my life, okay? Accountability on all sides, all right? And so I remember last night, one of my daughter's friends was like, we were sharing some of the favorite moments of Jasmine in their life, experiences for her birthday. And this girl gets up and says, hey, you know, I remember your daughter was in our class, and we were in the same grade, and we were in our class, and she noticed that my right leg was shorter than my left. So she asked her teacher, can I pray for this student? And the teacher's like, okay. And so my daughter sits her down. We have video of this. Sits her down and says, hey, I know that you have back problems and that comes from one leg being short, but God's going to heal your leg today. God told me. This is my daughter. She's 10 at this time. And she takes the girl's leg and says, Father, in the name of Jesus, grow this leg, and pulls the leg out just like that. This girl was there last night, showed us all the x-rays, the doctor's reports, everything last night. I'm going to have ruined kids. I don't want just normal kids. I'm not raising sons and daughters. I'm raising kings and queens, because I want to ruin people to storm this city and to storm this nation and to make a dent in the kingdom of hell. I'm telling you, I feel like heavens get excited and hell is getting nervous because of what's happening in this room, in this heart, in this family, in this, I don't know about you, but I feel like heaven's punching a hole in the roof of your vision, and there's a massive invasion happening because he doesn't want you to go back to normal. I remember one time my daughter, we were at a conference, and there was hundreds of people up at this altar, and man, people are getting messed up by God. I'm telling you, it's powerful. I'll never forget. I'm over here praying for someone. My oldest son's over here. My daughter, my wife is holding my youngest daughter as a baby and prophesying to somebody. And my daughter Jasmine is right here, and she sees a girl, and she goes, And this girl's looking at her, and She says, come here. She's like 6 at this time. And she says, God says that you're to have a smiley life and no more tears. Smiley life, no more tears. When she says it the second time, the power of God hits this girl and boom, goes back just like that. So Jazz is like, and she just kept walking. What we didn't know was this girl sent an email in to our ministry. And she said, hey, you don't know this, but your daughter was praying for me. And she told me I'm gonna have a smiley life and no more tears. And what she doesn't know is I'm 13, and since the age of 9, I have been diagnosed with clinical depression since the age of 9. And for 4 years, I have to take heavy medication just to keep my rhythms and my balances straight. And she said, but when I went down, I got up and I was totally different. She said, please tell your parents before you do this. I'm all for safety, okay? But she says, I ran back, didn't tell anybody, went back to my room, grabbed all my pills, and dumped them down the toilet. And she said, I have been off my pills ever since. Well, her mom finds her empty pill bottles. And all of a sudden, her mom freaks out. She's like, what's going on? What happened? She said, I went to camp. This is what happened. She's like, no, you've been selling them. What's going on? Oh, we don't know what's happening. Let's go to the doctor. She goes to the doctor, and the doctor uses this line. He said, now we've talked. And in order for you to have a normal life, you're supposed to take these pills. This girl jumps out of the chair and says, that's the problem. I've been ruined for normal, and I don't need to take those pills. And I gave my life to Jesus, and he doesn't have any side effects. And I don't have to take this one to this one. He is the way, the truth, the life. He is the one, and she has been free ever since. Why would that happen? Because a 6-year-old doesn't know normal. I pray you never discover normal Christianity. I pray you never discover normal church. May you never discover normal lives. May God cause you to dream so big that dreaming small scares you. May this be a place where no small dreams are allowed. May your marriage carry such an anointing that you are raising kids to look and not just lead nation, but nations. Are you following me? Where are the ruined ones at? Because they don't go back to normal. What I love about this, it says that they would lay this man daily at the gate. Did you get that? Daily. How long was daily? You'll find in the next chapter in the 22nd verse. It says for 40 years, this man was laid at the gate. Peter would go in through this gate all the time since his house was right down the street from this gate. And it says that he would walk in as a good Jewish man, if all the way to a boy, would walk in through this same gate. So every day of his life, he saw this beggar. So this is not a strange face. This is a familiar face to Peter. Are you following me? And he sees this man, except this time in Acts 3, something is different. Peter looks at this man with a different set of options. And he says, silver and gold I do not have, but what I do have, I will give you. Rise and walk in the name of Jesus. Now, what made this time different than all the other times? Peter had been ruined.
Remember, John chapter 18, he denies Jesus three times. John chapter 20, he literally makes this statement. John 21 verse 3, he says, I'm going fishing. Everybody say fishing. What was Peter before he was a disciple? A fisherman, right? He says, I'm going fishing. You know what he's saying? This is what he's not saying. He's not saying, I'm hungry, let me go fishing. He's not saying, I'm bored, let me go fishing. He's literally saying, I'm going back to what I used to be. He is going back to normal. Are you following me? And this is, and watch this. Then Jesus shows up at his point where he is trying to make steps to do that. This man catches nothing. Jesus says, hey, throw your net on the right side of the boat. They catch a catch, except this time Peter doesn't care about the catch. He dives in the water. The Bible says he swims 100 yards up to the shore of Peter and is completely restored. Why? Because the devil knew. He knew it was game over for Peter, just like he knows it's game over for you and all your issues and all your problems. Because if you just get one square good look into his eyes, it is game over for your problems. It is game over for your fear. It is game over for your marriage issues. It is game over for that sickness. I'm telling you today, the buzzer is ending and it is game over. God's kingdom is still moving in this city and he's still moving in your marriages and he still has his eye on you. Don't go back to normal. Don't go back to the way you used to worship. Don't go back to the way you used to pray. Demand more from yourself. Ask God where you want to journey me. Where are you asking to build me? Where are the ruined people at? Don't go back to normal. Here's the second thing. Number two, if you're going to be ruined, number two, dangerous places are safe places in the kingdom of God. Dangerous places are safe places in the kingdom of God. You know, I think one of the greatest lies on our generation of people isn't sin, go and be wicked, rebellious. That's not one of the greatest lies on our generation is just be normal. I'm telling you, another great lie is that you can have everything God offers you and not pay any cost for it. Not sure where we learned that. Look, salvation, that's free. Holy Spirit, he's free. Grace, that's free. But obedience, that will cost you. Dedication, cost you. Servanthood, cost you. Discipline, cost you. Faith, cost you. Are you following me? Are you seeing this? Dangerous places are safe places in the kingdom. Here's Peter. He says, look at us. What is he learning? He is learning a new lifestyle. Just like you in this day, you're not learning a new lifestyle because you went through a pandemic. You're learning a new lifestyle because you live in the prayer closet. You're not learning a new lifestyle because you've got circumstances. You're learning a new lifestyle because you've got character and integrity to back up and go against those circumstances. You've got anointing, authority, and have been positioned for that. And dangerous places are invitations to you. You're not intimidated by anything when you're ruined. You're ruined so well that you don't even look at giants. You just recognize, like, let me put you like this. The devil tried to throw a giant at David, not realizing David was really the giant. He tried to throw Daniel in a lion's den, not realizing Daniel brought a bigger lion in there with him called the Lion of Judah. He tried to throw three Hebrew children in a furnace, not realizing they were already on fire. He tried to bury Jesus at a grave, not realizing you can't bury life. I wonder what mistake he is making about Fearless Church, about your marriage, and about your children, that there are dangerous places that you feel drawn to. There is risk that you feel drawn to. And God is authorizing you with his faith and with his counsel to be able to take ground. It's time for the fearless to rise. Dangerous places are safe places in the kingdom of God. I'll never forget my son, Elisha. I'm telling a story about my kids because I miss them. I remember my son, we were out at dinner one night, and we've always taught our kids to just stop. Hey, what's God saying right now? We'll be at dinner, or we'll be at home, or we'll be in shopping or wherever, and we'll stop and say, hey, is God saying anything right now? And they'll do a quick check. No, he's saying this. I can't tell you how many times they've told me what message I'm preaching that weekend. They've named the points. They had a dream, told me the dream. It came to pass several months later. I'm telling you, it was powerful. And I remember we were out to eat, and this waiter comes over and takes our order, and then my son goes, and my wife's like, what's the matter? He's like, well, God's speaking to me. And, well, what's he saying? He said, well, he wants me to tell this waiter that he has a great voice and he's not going to die. And I'm like, well, how do you start this conversation? So we did what any parent does. We made our kid do it. It's good parenting. So sure enough, this waiter comes back and gives us our drinks, takes our food order, and he's about to walk away. And I said, sir, listen, we're Christians and God speaks to us. And my son has something he wants to tell you. And my son is coloring. He must have been like 5 or 6. My son is, he's 13 now. He's coloring like this. And he goes, God says that you have a great life and you're not gonna die. And he yells this over the restaurant. And I'm like, dude, what's the matter? Why are you being weird? What's the matter? He yells, you're not gonna die. I'm like, shut your mouth. You don't have to say it like that, right? And this waiter, he goes, and runs off crying. I mean, weeping, crying. And I told my wife, like, we gotta go. We gotta go. She's like, no, we're not leaving. They're gonna spit in our food. We need to go. Come on, let's go. And she said, no, we're staying. I said, fine, if we die, it's your fault. So the waiter comes back after several minutes, and you could tell he's been crying, weeping this whole time. He didn't even talk to us. He bypasses us and goes straight to my son. And he goes over and goes, now tell me what he said one more time. And my son is annoyed that he has to repeat himself. He's like, I said, you have a great voice, and God says you're not going to die. And this guy's like, oh my gosh. Oh my. He's like kneeling at the, oh my gosh. He's like weeping. And I'm like, hey, we just trying to eat. Like, and he's weeping. Kid you not, weeping. And I said, sir, does this make any sense? Maybe I can help out. He says, somebody better do something because this kid is freaking me out right now. And I said, sir, tell me, what does this mean to you? He said, I'm an artist. And I had a few opportunities, few labels looking at me. I was getting ready to sign pretty much the contract of my life. And he said, but this is what he said. He said, it was his dad. His dad had died in a car accident that week, so he stopped. Then his brother died, and then a friend of his died. All within 3 weeks, one right at the other. Car accidents. And so he said, I felt like I was next. So I remember he said, I with that fear of being feeling like you're, and everything you do could lead to your death, he said, I couldn't sing as good as I could. I couldn't do anything anymore. And he said, so I can't sing as good as I used to, and I have to work this job just to pay my bills. And I look over at my son, and I'm like, not bad. Not bad. Sure enough, I said, son, pray for this man. So he goes over, Father, in the name of Jesus, I say that he has a great voice, and then he shouts it again. He's not going to die! And he yells it. This guy is crying. This guy gets an encounter. Why? Because this kid doesn't know dangerous places from safe places. When you're ruined, you'll realize God doesn't just work in church. He doesn't just work in the altars. He doesn't just work at conference. He works in your marriage. He works with your kids. He works at your job. He is with you. He is following you. He's positioning you. You are a chess piece on his board. And while the enemy is playing checkers, God is playing chess. And he's trying to position you and posture you so you could stay ruined. Here's the last thing if you're going to be ruined. Number three. If you're going to be ruined, you need to understand he is the God of right now. He's the God of right now. Like I said, I felt like my assignment this morning was to provoke you. What I've noticed is that after doing so many conferences and leading in the church, it's always like the weekend or two after the church, it's like the spiritual high that was in the people somehow falls away. And it's like all our normal comes back. And that hunger wanes, that vision gets blurry, and it's almost like we took 3 steps back now instead of 2 steps forward. And I just want to keep you from that. You know, 1 John says, be careful to not lose that which you have gained. And I feel like God has put such a thunder on the inside of this vision in this house, inside of your hearts for a reason. It wasn't for a weekend. You were here for some Christian getaway. You're not here for church to sing spiritual karaoke and get your little goosebump so you can go home and live the same way. No, you came here because you know God is ruining you. He's not going to leave you like he met you. He's going to transform you in every sense of the way. And I truly believe that what he's doing right now, is he's awakening you to a supernatural reality that he does not live in time and space because he is the God of right now. I like Hebrews 13:8. It says Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Now, I love when it says yesterday, because you could say yesterday means like the good old days. And I have people literally tell me, Pastor Chris, they always talk about the good old days. They talk about how things were back when and how God moved here and what it was like back in this place. Now, listen, I'm all for what God poured out 30, 40 years ago. Man, I celebrate that. We stand on the shoulders of those pioneers. But at the same time, I don't want 40-year stale oil. I want a fresh outpouring for myself in this season. Come on, anyone who has an ear, let him hear. And then there's this other place where God lives. It's called the forever, or the someday. I literally had people tell me, Pastor Chris, someday I'll do what your kids do. Someday I'll live that life. Someday I'll take risks like Pastor Jeremy, Pastor Christy. Someday I'll walk with integrity. Someday. Well, there was a space in between the good old days and someday, and it was called today. And in English, which they didn't have in Hebrew, we have a word called now. Whoever you need God to be, He can be that right now. If you need Him to heal your body, He can do that right now. If you need Him to set your mind free from all this depression and all this demonic attack and all these thoughts, He can do that right now. If you needed God to heal your marriage and be a restorer of your life, He can do that right now. If you needed God to wash sin right off of you so that you don't live a wicked life and you don't waste your life in the same cycles that your parents had and your grandparents have, but you become renewed and you become strengthened and hidden in Christ Jesus by surrendering to His Lordship and embracing Him as a friend, can I tell you, He can be that right now. One of the most greatest evangelists on the planet in the last 100 years was a man named Reinhard Bonnke. I remember I was sitting in my office with Reinhard, and Reinhard told me, he said, Chris, whoever you preach Jesus to be, that's who He'll be. If you preach Him to be a healer, He'll show up and heal people. If you preach Him to be a deliverer, He'll show up and set people free. If you preach Him to be a savior and snatching men and women's souls out of hell, He'll do that. I'm here to tell you, He can be everything right now. I don't know where you're at, but I do know silver and gold I do not have, because I live in California. Joke. But what I do have, I can offer you plenty of that. Because it's not on loan, it's not on consignment, and it's not on layaway. It's for every man and every woman. Would you stand up with me this morning? I feel the anointing of God in this building. I feel the presence of God. I really feel a move. I don't know. This is my first time here, literally, first time here. But I do sense I was sent here. I do sense that God asked me to come via Pastor Jerry, Pastor Christie's invitation, which I'm so humbled by. But I do believe that God is trying to get fearless into a warrior way of thinking. I'm all for being aware, but I'm not here to live a post-pandemic life. I'm here to live a life that matters, because we got single moms that can't provide food for their babies. And I want to make sure that I'm not huddled up in my own insecurity while I can do something and don't do anything. I want to be ruined. When we got drug addicts who need freedom, like I was, and need a touch from heaven, and what they need is for me to inconvenience myself, and if at risk at the highest level, embarrass myself at praying for them. I want to live a ruined life. I believe there are people whose marriages need somewhat of a restart, if not a reset, because there's been so much damage to the trust, and there's been so much words that have been said. It's just been one thing after another, and I feel like God is severing the timeline. And it's saying, today something's new. You're going to get ruined. See, I don't know where you're at. I really don't. Whether you're here in the building or you're watching online, but I know God can mark your life. You're not just here to be marketable. You're here to be marked.
And what God wants to do in your life is he wants to set you so different and so changed that you risk it all and you live a fearless life. And there is something about you that draws the world's attention and says, how do they live? How do they dream? What do they do? What school they graduated from? And all you can say is, just like Peter and John, we had been with Jesus. We're not that good. We're not that skilled. We're not that educated, but I know how to pray and I know how to prophesy and I know how to fast and I know how to trust in his word, and I refuse to be moved by headlines and news cycles and propaganda and this thing and this cycle and this social media. I move at his word. I'm ruined. I'm preaching there's a bigger God with a bigger assignment that has a bigger mission, because I'm ruined. Where are the ruined at this morning? I'm not talking about churchgoers. I'm talking like God is sending you out. You know what I feel? This is what I feel. I just going off script here. I feel like this isn't a church. This is an armory. That's what I felt when I walked in. This is where God houses weapons. This is where he sharpens and polishes, chisels and enlarges. I feel like there's a bunch of arrows and spears and swords and shields, javelins in this room right here. I don't know where you're at, but I do know the hand of God is on every one of you.
You know, honey, something that is a part of our spiritual journey and that we're talking about in Acts 18 right now is giving to the Lord. And, you know, you preached such an eloquent message at Acts 18 this week about that exact thing, about your offerings to the Lord, that we give a tithe, that's a part of our 10%, that giving back. It's really not giving to God, it's just returning.
Yes.
But then that offering that we pray about, I want you to encourage those people that are watching right now about giving that offering.
Yeah. You know, the Bible says to give both in our tithes and our offerings. Really, this principle of multiplication is activated not just through tithing, because really tithing is not giving. Tithing is returning. So it's just returning to God back what he originally gave us. So really you're moving into an area of giving when you go into offerings that are over and above. And this principle of multiplication in your life begins to be activated, whether it's financially, whether it's in your health, whether it's in your family. And I just want to encourage you today. Maybe you've just been a tither, and that's one level of blessing, but there is a whole nother realm of the supernatural that is opened up as we begin to move into this area of offering. So I want to encourage you today in our tithes and our offerings.
Incredible.
To listen to the Lord, even our fasting. We're listening to the Lord in every area.
Yes.
And so this is an area that you submit to the Lord. God, what would you have me give? And that's a hard question to ask the Lord, because he could say anything. Holy Spirit could say a number that's really hard, but that's really where there's a testing of our faith. And that's where growth happens.
Yeah, growth happens in this spot. So as you give today, and as you are challenged by us to give, we're not here to press people to give. We ask you to do what we're doing, and just as disciples of Christ ourselves, leaning into the Holy Spirit and letting him press on our hearts, because if he says it, he's going to cover us. And so we're going to give that today. You can text to give. You can give in many ways through the little links they're putting up. Let's give today. And we want to pray over your giving today as you give. And everything you give today is going to be to fund the kingdom, to fuel the kingdom, to advance the kingdom here on this earth. Why don't you pray over their giving?
Yes, Lord. We thank you, God, that we get so we can give. And so, Lord, I pray that our giving is like a river and not a reservoir. A reservoir grows stagnant, God. But, Lord, a river keeps flowing in and out of us and through us. Lord, I pray, God, that every resource we have, we get the understanding that it is to advance the kingdom of God. So I pray, God, that you bless your people today. In Jesus' name, amen.
What an amazing day it has been. What a powerful word. Again, if this is your first time joining us, we want to welcome you to our Fearless family. So be sure to text the keyword fearless to our fearless number so we can say hi and welcome you properly. Church, we love you. You're incredible. Happy Sunday.